Around the World with MS World. I'm Dr. Daniel Kantor, Chief Medical Correspondent. Here at the American Academy of Neurology annual meeting, we're in the poster session, and one of our focuses is on pediatric onset multiple sclerosis. And I'm so happy to be joined here by Professor Olga Ciccarelli, who is a professor of neurology at University College London. And in your work, you looked at a consortium of people, looked at the issue of diagnosis of kids with multiple sclerosis. When we say pediatric onset multiple sclerosis, what do we mean?
We mean onset of MS below the age of 16. We look at differences between children who have onset below the age of 12, children who have onset of MS above the age of 12, but usually we consider below the age of 16.
And what were you trying to do? You looked at a diagnostic algorithm. What does that mean? For people back home who might not be familiar with the word algorithm, what does that mean?
Yeah, so we were trying to understand what are the main characteristics of children who present with relapsing demyelinating disorder. And this is a very large spectrum that includes a lot of different phenotypes, a lot of different diseases. So it could be a bit difficult, challenging for the doctor to diagnose which is the correct disease. So we're trying to provide some tools so that the doctor can improve the diagnostic skills. And we did this by retrospectively studying children who were already diagnosed with some relapsing demyelinating disorders, and we look back at these children and we said, okay, so what is the main characteristics of this disease, what is the main characteristics of this other disease, and then at the end we defined an algorithm for which we said which are the main tests that needs to be done in which order to facilitate the diagnostic.
So when you look retrospectively, so you look at people's charts who you already know what their diagnosis is, and then you're going backwards and figuring out which tests are important and which aren't. So which tests are important?
So the first test to be done is a brain and spinal cord MRI scan. The majority of children in this cohort, in fact, had MS. A minority had other diseases. So first of all, MRI. If MRI is suggestive of MS, apply the same criteria that adults MS patients have, and then this is sorted. And then the remaining have to go through another test. But before starting to do blood tests to look for antibodies, it's important to see whether there are typical clinical features, because at the end, a diagnosis is still very much guided by clinical signs and clinical symptoms. So we said after MRI, if a child has features suggestive of NMO spectrum disorder, then we can test antibodies, aquaporin for antibodies. If they have antibodies, done. NMO spectrum disorder with aquaporin for positive testing. If they don't have aquaporin for antibodies, then we said, okay, that is the time of check MOG antibodies. If they don't have MOG antibodies, then we have to keep the child under observation, see how it goes over time, and repeat the same algorithm, perhaps at the next relapse. If they have MOG antibodies positive, then we diagnose MOG antibody associated disease. And this is challenging because I understand that in the US there is no approved testing for MOG antibodies. So this is something that we do in the UK, we do in Europe, but I think, you know, it's possible that in the near future there will be testing for MOG antibodies available in the US as well.
So the first testing we do is really to see, does this person have multiple sclerosis? Because MS is going to be the most common. And then if it doesn't look like MS, then we check for something called NMO, or neuromyelitis optica spectrum disorder. NMO is also called DeVix disease sometimes. And then if they don't have that, then we look for something that we're only starting to hear about in the last several years called MOG. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah.
What is MOG?
Yeah, so this is, okay, it's still quite debatable, I think, how we're going to define these patients. I think the majority of MOG positive cases are either NMO spectrum disorder without aquaporin for antibodies. So a subgroup of these patients have MOG antibodies. And then in this cohort, we saw all the relapsing ADEM, in fact, were MOG positive. So,
okay. And ADEM is, what happens in ADEM?
So it's an acute disseminated encephalomyelitis, where it's like an acute episode of inflammatory demyelination of the brain. And it's considered to be isolated, more classically isolated. If there is a relapsing ADEM over time, in this cohort, all of them had MOG antibodies.
Well, I want to thank you so much for helping to shed a light on how things are a little bit different in Europe than they are in the United States, and how they're different in kids than they are in adults. And for all of you back home, I want to thank you for joining us as well.